I was on the road less traveled, I think. I kept thinking of that book while I was driving somewhere in the countryside. Anyway, it was just kind of interesting how it all happened. I was getting close to Highway 80, and I'd left my house about 8:30. It usually takes me about an hour to get here. And I had put it into my car's GPS. Do people have a GPS? Some of you in your car? Anyway, I thought, well, this will be easy. I'll just use my car GPS. And it told me to keep going and not get on Highway 80. This is really weird. So I punched it in again, and I saw these two little squiggly roads taking me here. And I thought, oh, this is great. I'll just try something new because it said, I'll be here at 9:34. Great, you know, it's about how much time it normally takes me. So I'm heading on, I get off on Appian Way, I'm on some Alhambra Road for 8 miles. Totally no people anywhere, bicycle riders. I'm like, gee, well, at least I'm kind of heading east. This is a good thing. And then all of a sudden I looked and it said I would get there at 9:34. And I looked at the clock when I called you, and it was like 9:24, and I still had 34 miles to go. I'm like, something is wrong with this picture. Well, apparently my GPS does not know about daylight savings time. That's what, at any rate, I stopped, I called Amy, she called me back, I put it on my phone, and it got me onto Highway 4, and I made it here in good time. But it was interesting how I had this inner divide going on in the outer, because what's my talk title today? It's not resistance. I know you're talking about resistance, but we'll find resistance in here, I'm sure. My talk title is Dissolve the Inner Divide. Dissolve the Inner Divide. And I thought, well, I've got this thing on my, this outer divide, and I have to dissolve it by taking one of them, I guess, because I didn't have any alternative at the time. Anyway, as I was driving, I was thinking about inner divides inside myself when I was a kid. You know, I think when we are first little kids, we don't really have a lot of inner divides. We're just present to what's there in the moment. But as we grow a little bit older, people start giving us some direction in how we should show up in the world, right? Anybody have that, like your parents telling you, you should be, I was always told to be sweet. And when I look back on that, my mother telling me, be sweet, I have to think, maybe I wasn't very sweet. Or she wouldn't have been telling me to be sweet, right? I mean, there must have been something going on there that I'm not aware of, but be sweet was one of my guidelines as growing up. And I was thinking about a time in my life when I had a really, really good friend. Her name was Joni Greengard. And it was probably first, second, third grade. And we played, we rode our bikes together, we rode to school, we played tetherball, and we would often go over to Joni's house and go upstairs to her bedroom and play dress up. And we would sing to musicals. We knew all the words to all sorts of musicals, and we'd dress up and sort of pretend like we were stars. And it was really, really fun. What started happening, though, with that friendship was we started getting grades in school. And then there developed this little bit of competition between us. It was very, very subtle, but it was just like, you know, I want to make sure that I get at least a good grade as Joni gets. And if she got a better grade, mm-hmm. then I started to feel kind of bad. Am I the only one who had this experience? Well, the interesting thing, I mean, talk about comparison, like the mind wants to compare, and then there's a little bit of competition going on. I mean, this is, we're like in first grade, right? Second grade, but it's very active. So fast forward to I'm starting my church, and I reconnected with Joni, because we've gone our separate ways. I went to a different high school, we went to colleges, different places, and I didn't connect. I come to find out that Joni has started a business. And the business she started was Gymboree. Does anyone ever heard of Gymboree? Gymboree was a really big deal. It was like a program to teach kids, and kind of kids learned to do physical things, and their moms were there. It was very good. Anyway, Joni started Gymboree. Well, this was about the time that I was starting Unity of Berkeley. And I was making $1,200 a month, you know? And I'm like, the mind of comparison.
Fast forward.
Joni started Gymboree, and then she sold it to Larry Mendel, and then she now owns Yoga Works. I'm like, okay, I got to deal with this. So, and that's kind of part of what happens inside of us, isn't it? Well, and it may not be that you have a Joni in your life, you know, but you may have a brother, or you may have a sister, you may have a partner, that somehow you feel you need to, like, be in that place of a little bit of competition, a little bit of comparison. The other thing that happens for many of us, and this is where it starts to get really serious, we start judging ourselves based on some ideal of who we think we are. It's no longer about Joni and me not measuring up to whatever she's been able to do, but I start creating a standard inside myself about how I need to show up in the world. And for some of us, that can be, I need to be somebody who's always taking care of your needs. Whatever I'm going to do, the decisions I'm going to make, I want to make sure that you are going to be happy with whatever I do. Mm. Anybody know about that? We could call that part of ourselves that some of us have. Maybe some people don't have that. Bless you. You know, that we would be pleasers. Our deal is like I got to be careful that I'm going to please you based on the decisions that I make in my life. Now, some people are like that. Other people, while they might not be pleasers, they might be people who need to prove themselves in the world. And somebody like that might have had, say, you got hurt once in your life, and you're carrying on kind of a resentment about somebody hurt your feelings, and you just need to prove to them how wrong they are and what a good person you are. And so you run around as a prover trying to prove that they're wrong and you're right. When we're in those places in consciousness, we're in a place of inner division. There's a divide going on inside of us. There's either the sense that something I'm doing is not right, somehow what I'm being is not right, I need to somehow make a change here. I need to be seen differently in the world. So this is a really important thing for us to be aware of in our lives. And I've been in Unity, thank you, Jan, sharing a little bit of my Unity journey, because I found Unity in 1990. My dad had just died, and I was dealing with some heavy use of Chardonnay as my strategy. and it was through that 12-step program that I actually went to Unity for the first time, and it was such a blessing for me. I think for me, the piece of Unity that was so powerful was sitting in the silence. It was like there was something about the collective silence that allowed me to silence the inner craziness and chaos that was going on inside me. And that was such a gift. And I used to split out the back door before anybody could see me. And I always tell those people in the back, you may be a minister someday, so you never know how it can grab you. At any rate, it was so interesting for me when I first found Unity, because for me, what was really powerful in Unity was the truth teachings and the principles. I really could grab onto the principles that Unity had to teach. Right. And I think about it now, as I became a licensed Unity teacher, the principles were so important for me. Charles Fillmore's teachings and the 12 powers, the teachings about the different levels of consciousness, that we are, you know, we have the unconscious mind, the subconscious mind that we're not really aware of, and then we have that conscious mind that we can connect with one another, and then there's the super conscious mind that hopefully we can tap in and out of much of our life. And when I was a teacher, and then even starting my Unity Church in Berkeley, by the way, pioneering means you have a covered wagon, and you are dragging all your books, you're dragging the coffee pot, all the chairs, you're putting them up, and then you're taking them away, and then you're going back with your wagon. That's what a pioneer does. It's exhausting, very exhausting. At any rate, the principles kind of kept me going. The truth principles kept me going. But what I realized later, as I got more involved in Unity, the principles were taught to us by Charles Fillmore. But it was what Myrtle was doing, what Emily Cady was doing, that really energized me. And it was interesting because I was looking at some of my old books yesterday as I prepared for being with you today. And I found one of these, Myrtle, How to Let God Help You. Myrtle was really practical. She wasn't just giving you principles. She's saying, okay, they're principles, but this is how you're going to use these principles in your life every single day. Emily Cady, who wrote, what did Emily Cady write? What was the first one? Lessons in Truth. Lessons in Truth was like a primer for Unity teachings. And Unity used that as a background and a teaching for many, many years. Then she wrote this book called How I Use Truth. And I thought, this is kind of interesting to me because it feels like kind of the masculine energy that came up through Unity was about principle. It was about teaching the principles. And in a way, what you were talking about with Eckhart Tolle is talking about, you know, we want to be in the beingness of who we are. Whereas the Divine Feminine was giving us the how-to. How do we do it? These are the principles, but how do I use this in my life? You know, what's the nitty-gritty? And we were talking about birthing. So it's like the Divine Feminine is doing the birthing of how we actually walk through the world living these powerful truth principles. So what I was thinking about this talk and thinking about this whole idea of the inner divide, where this talk title came to me is from a book that my teachers in India wrote. It's called The Four Sacred Secrets. And it, again, is a guide. It's not just like, okay, these are secrets that are concepts and principles. We're going to give you a guide for love and prosperity, a guide for living in the beautiful state, of living a beautiful life. And what I realized was, in my world, in terms of what I've been doing in my spiritual journey since finding Unity in 1990, it's been about taking those principles and really owning them in my life in a way that they become so real and so active that they're no longer principles. They're actually how my life unfolds and how it shows up day after day, week after week, in my relationships and the work that I do in the world. And so I think it's really important for us to understand that that is the basis of what Unity is all about. And I was really enjoying reading Emily Cady because I haven't looked at this book for a very long time. The very first part of this book, Emily Cady is writing a letter to Charles Fillmore's son, who was a publisher at the time, and she's basically kind of slapping somebody's wrist because she said, people have taken chapters out of my book and just willy-nilly just published them, and that's not right because they need to know all that went into my life for me to be able to write this book. I didn't just like randomly write a book about how to use truth. I practiced it over years and years and years, and then I wrote the book. And you have to understand that that's how it works when we're teaching these things. And what she said that I thought was so powerful was, the thing that we need to do if we're going to be truth students, if we're going to be good Unity students, if we're going to actually embody what Jesus, the Christ being that Jesus was, what he did and how he lived his life, is we have to understand that there's a difference between people who say they're Christian, people who say they're Christian and they believe that Jesus died for them, Jesus died on the cross, they're saved because of Jesus, where they're somehow experiencing Jesus out here. And what Unity is teaching, which is that Christ nature, the divine nature that Jesus has, is in each one of us all the time, every moment. That we embody the Christ Christ. It's not about something out there. That the embodiment of the Christ presence is what Jesus was teaching his disciples. It's what he's teaching us all the time. And it's literally what Charles Fillmore is teaching us. We talk about the divine within, the Christ presence within. So that whole idea of how do we embody that divine Christ presence? How do we embody the God presence in our life? Because this go round, we have this humanness, don't we? And in my humanness, and I think in some of yours, we don't always carry those high ideals in consciousness that we can talk about and think about and read about in our daily life. A lot of times we live in a world internally, in our inner world, where we're feeling conflict. We're feeling divided. How do we deal with that? How do we deal with that? And, you know, Charles didn't really tell us so much how to deal with it. Myrtle told us how to deal with it. And her way to deal with it was actually what Jesus did. You know, we don't know what Jesus' life was like, really, before those 3 years when we read about him. But we do know during those 3 years, what was he doing all the time? He was heading up to the mountain and praying. He would leave whatever the situation is. He would go off, and he would be in the stillness. He would be in the silence. He would kind of regroup himself into, call it a remembering, call it a reminding. I mean, remembering is like it's coming back into all the members of the physical body of who we are as these Christed beings, these divine beings that we inherit, everything that Jesus inherited. And so in this day, in this age, where we're living right now, I think it's very challenging for us to remember who we are, to remember that Christ nature that is who each one of us came here not only to live and be, but to carry that energy out into the world. And yes, we are in a time where more and more people are awakening to that nature. But the issue still happens for us that there's so much going on, so much activity, so much information, so many more things that we have to do in our world than, for instance, our parents did, or certainly our grandparents. And what that causes for many of us is this kind of inner chaos. And for some people, it's almost like a claustrophobia, like an inner claustrophobia, where the mind is constantly divided. It's telling us, well, you know, you need to be a really good mother. You have these beautiful children. You need to be a good mother. And you need to earn money in order to send your children to daycare, in order to send your children to school. And so you need to put time into the work that you do. How does that work for a young mother? Because when she's at work, what she may be thinking about? I should be with my children. And when she's with her kids, she might be thinking about, oh, there's that idea. I could be doing that if I weren't here watching my child. So we get into these kind of inner dialogue, inner split that can happen for us. And what happens when that inner split happens? What happens for you when you're feeling divided inside yourself? Tell me.
Chaos.
What?
Anxiety.
Chaos. What else?
Anxiety.
You doubt yourself? You become indecisive?
Depression.
No, right?
Self-judgment.
Self-judgment. You're judging yourself. You're going, you doubt yourself. Maybe I should be here, maybe I should be there. And whenever that happens, whenever we're in that push me, pull me place, where we're feeling disconnected from the present moment because we think we should be somewhere else, we should be acting some different way, we're judging ourselves, whenever that happens, we literally cannot be present. We're not present to that Christ presence, that divine energy that will guide us moment to moment, that we'll be present to whatever it is our life purpose is. And the self-judgment that you talk about, Mom, such an insidious thing for us. Think about for a minute, if you have a friend that you really like and you start judging your friend, there's something your friend is doing that you're not too keen on. What are some of the strategies you might? You might try to change your friend. You might give them a little advice, right? You might then, if they're not following and it starts to get more distant, you might start distancing yourself. Maybe you're not returning their phone calls. Maybe you maybe kind of back away from that relationship, and maybe eventually you just kind of develop an indifference to that person so that you're not connecting with them at all. What if, instead of that being a friend, what if that's how you're acting toward yourself? Because you've become disconnected from yourself, where you're pulling yourself away from the truth of who you are because you can't really make proper connection with the divine presence because you're living in this kind of an inner divide. One of the biggest things that happens for us is the way we should ourselves. We should be this way, or we should not be this way. We should our bodies, don't we? How is your body supposed to be in the world? Do you look at your body when you walk by a big window, like, suck it in? I noticed, I was with Amy, we went to this great event with Marianne Williamson, and I noticed all the pictures with TJ, he's got his neck like this. And he told me later, he said, you know, you put your neck up like that. I looked at mine, I'm like, well, the wrinkles are showing. Keep your neck up when you're doing a selfie. I don't know about a selfie, so I don't know about it. But that should, it's good, oh, I should have these wrinkles. Do you do that about your family? I mean, maybe, you know, there are aspects of family that we don't like to discuss. You know, things that are happening in a family that you just want to keep close. Or even about the home you live in, is it supposed to look somehow different than it does? Roy and I live in a house that had my mother's things, my brother's things, my things, his things. There's things. There's things in our house. And, you know, we try to keep it organized. But then you go someplace where it's all new and fresh and everything's gray. Gray is the new white, apparently. I read that somewhere. Where there's nothing on the tables, and it's just very clean, and, you know, and we were looking at some TV show, and he said, oh, I like our stuff. It's, you know, it's kind of cozy. It's home. There's no judgment around that. But what is it for you? What is it that you have created in your own inner world where you're judging yourself? Maybe something you're feeling not right about your work, the work you're doing in the world, or maybe there's a relationship that you have right now where you're being pulled. You know, you want to give time to a family member. Maybe you're in a place where you're in a caregiving mode where you need to be taking care of a family member and you love that person, you want to be present to them. But at the same time, you know you have your own desires, your own needs to be out in the world, to be giving your gifts in a different way. And so there's that inner, that sense of the inner divide. And as long as we're in that place, we're not in the present moment. We can't really even connect to the divine, to God, in that time when we're in that place of push me, pull me, inner divide. And whether it's a sense of doubt, a sense of shame, a sense of self-judgment, and a sense of blaming yourself or blaming the other, it doesn't matter what it is. The key thing is awareness. It's what can you become aware of that is causing this inner split? It's awareness that will begin to dissolve this inner split that all of us carry at some level. And the thing about awareness is there's I think he's a psychiatrist. His name is Dan Siegel. He's a doctor. And he talks about this important understanding of how the brain works, that when we are observing something, so observing an inner truth, for instance, or say, say you have some fear, you're observing that, gee, I'm feeling a little bit fearful about standing up and talking. I'm not, by the way. But, you know, if I were feeling fearful about that, then I would observe it. What happens when we focus our awareness and we begin to observe, the neural pathways in the brain shift. The pathway that keeps us connected to the amygdala, which is more fight or flight, where we're in that sort of destructive place, the energy moves into what's called the mid-prefrontal cortex of the brain. And that mid-prefrontal cortex aspect of the brain is where higher intelligence exists. it also is a place inside the brain that allows us to experience connection. And connection doesn't just mean my connection to you, to each person here. Connection is the connection we have with all life. It's the connection that Jesus talked about. The Father and I are one. You don't come to the Father without coming through me, and the through me is through that place inside of us that is connected to all life. So there's an actual neurological shift that happens for us, and an actual way that we can dissolve this inner divide, and that is to focus our attention on whatever is coming up, whatever we see. And sometimes it might be we see both sides. You know, we see I really want to do this, but at the same time I don't. I want to be present to this friend of mine, but at the same time I have this other thing that I want to do for myself. And we see both those things, and we see that kind of self-centered nature of who we are. We see that. And as we do that, very gently, the energy moves from the back, fight or flight, kind of indestructive chaos, into this place inside the brain, the prefrontal cortex. So I'm going to just take you a two-second little meditation on this. And for those of you who are going to join me this afternoon, we're going to do three different meditations to just kind of give you some ideas of how you can make these shifts in consciousness. Because affirmations and denials are one thing, but it's a different way to actually activate areas of the brain. So I invite you to close your eyes just for a moment. And just be present right now to whatever is going on inside you, whatever that feeling might be. It could be a feeling of, oh, I'm so glad it's almost over, you know? Oh, or it could be, oh, this is so great to be with my community, I'm feeling really connected. It could be a sense of, I've got something to do later in the day and I really don't really want to do it, how am I going to fit this in? It could be a sense of joy, it could be a sense of happiness, it could be some sort of fear, it could be an anxiety. Whatever it is, just take a moment to just feel what's going on inside. Notice where it is in the physical body. There's a sensation in the body. Just be aware of that sensation. And take a moment just to notice the movement of your thinking around this feeling. Are you obsessing with something that happened in the past that's causing this feeling? Are you fully present in the moment with this feeling? Or do you have anxiety about the future that's causing this feeling? Just be aware. Thinking in the past, is it in the present or is it in the future? And from that awareness now, bring your attention and your focus to that space right in between your eyebrows, right between the brows, and imagine the tiny, tiny little flame right there. If you can't imagine it in your mind's eye, just have a sense of feeling a little flame right there in between the eyebrows. And slowly bring that flame straight back into the center of the skull. So it's floating there, a little tiny flame. Dissolve any sense of inner divide. So thank you so much.